Okay, first of all, we would like to say shalom to everyone. We put a class together. Well, I today put a class together based on what's going on in the earth concerning Bible prophecy, predominantly within the Americas. Okay? Do me a favor. Can you shut that? It's a lot of noise. Specifically in the Americas. Okay. There's a lot of things going on at one time. So many things is happening that it would probably confuse the world concerning prophecy. There's so many things our people can't put a bead on it. So we thought that we would go into these prophecies to show you where we are present day prophecy. Present day according to the Most High. All right. Now, there's a lot of things going on in America. People have been sending me reports and information that links directly to a lot of the teachings that we were teaching while in Babylon concerning how they would eventually implement the mark of the beast. All right, as you know, they're looking to cut a certain amount off of the rolls of EBT within the United States, which is about $5 billion. Okay? And that's prominent in prophecy because this is not being done because there's a lack of money or lack of wealth within the earth. This is an orchestrated effort that's repeating itself. This happened once before in history, going back to 70 AD. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to parallel our fall when we fell as a people and show you the similarities and the comparison to how it's being done today. Nonetheless, high tech, it's still being done parallel to how Rome destroyed the Jews. Now, what is the importance of this and why is this important according to the Bible? Well, one key thing that we've been teaching for a long time is that there have been a misrepresentation concerning the fall of the children of Israel, of God's people, and a high-level denial amongst religious institutions in identifying what people relates to prophecy when you parallel them with the children of Israel in the Bible. There's been a lack of attention from religious mainstream of identifying these particular people. What we're going to find out today is that these particular people are on the brunt end of what the empire is about to do to them worldwide, not only in the United States. That this is prophecy of the continuing siege against Israel. So what we're going to do is we're going to call this lesson today the final siege of the children of Israel. Now, I know that when, and I just want to address this because we know we have a lot of pastors and preachers and those that have congregations and churches may follow some of the lessons. This is a direct broadcast to you to a lot of degrees. Why? In the church, when you teach of 70 AD, you teach that it was the church that ran into the wilderness. When you read Revelation, the 12th chapter, this is part of mainstream teaching in Christianity. But listen here clearly. It didn't matter, and I'm going to go into it in a moment. It didn't matter what religious persuasion the Israelites and Jews were in 70 AD. They were taken down nonetheless. It didn't matter whether or not they followed Christ. It was because of their bloodline and threat to the Roman Empire through bloodline, they were destroyed. Now, that's key because this will give us the biblical understanding of who the children of Israel are and who we must rally behind and protect in the last days. If we are really Christ-following Christians. Now, let's go into the siege. What we have here is information from mainstream media. Okay? And I'm going to show you how this all relates back to when we fell in Rome. A lot of you don't even know that the minorities or black people or the people who have been enslaved by imperialist Rome or Great Britain, that these particular people are the children of Israel that are scattered throughout the four corners of the earth. They've been scattered according to prophecy. Okay? When these particular people fell, they lost their identity, and therefore the Gentile nations, predominantly Rome, or who we call the Jewish people today, set up an educational program that would keep the Romans in charge while lying to the population whom they're destroying, knowing in fact that these people they are destroying are the children of Israel. So they put an educational system in place that would have the people absorb into the republic and fight for the republic, opposed to having nationalistic ideas towards their own nation. So they have taken our people down worldwide and absorbed us into the republic in which we fight against ourselves. So by us not identifying ourselves nationally as a people, we have no idea that war is being aimed towards us. And that's a key piece that the Christian churches are denying. That this is a bloodline war against people. So slavery did not happen by chance. It didn't happen just through coincidence. And we can no longer use the excuse that, well, every empire enslaved people had some form of slavery in their system as an excuse to ignore the slavery on a global scale that have happened to our people. We can't use that as an excuse no more, because why? There's no place in history where black people enslaved over 1 million Chinese people. There's no place in history where black people enslaved over 1 million white people and brought them over in slave ships. So this slavery that our people have witnessed on this earth is a phenomenon in which the whole nation have been brought low by imperialistic Rome. And there's a parallel, because who are the people that are about to get cut off? Predominantly cut off in these inner cities. Is this a global conspiracy against a particular people? Absolutely. But the problem is the people whom the conspiracy is against have no idea why there's a conspiracy against them. They have no idea that they are the people of the Bible, and that because of this prophecy concerning them to one day rise, you are a threat to the Roman Empire. Whether you accept the truth of who you are or not, you're still a threat. They're looking to totally annihilate you. Okay? So what we're going to do is go into some parallels of ancient Rome when our people were taken down, and modern day time right before the coming of our Lord, to show you that that 70 AD takedown was just the beginning of the takedown. The siege had been going on ever since. Now we're at what you would call the height of the desolation. Why? Because they could not accomplish the destruction of Israel all at once back then. Now you might ask, well, why they have all the power and the ammunition? Well, why don't they just take us out all at once? Well, the same reason they couldn't take us out all at once in the past. We are vast in number. And if they took us out, if they assumed war against us all at once, we would rally together. And the empires of this world are afraid that if we rally together, like we once were in Israel, that our God would operate with us as one. A nation divided against itself cannot stand, so they must destroy us while we're in a state of division. They cannot do anything to move us as one with one idea against them. And this moves to another thing that I'm going to talk about within this lesson, is that this, if you believe and understand, it's no longer time to debate with others what the Bible say concerning what you must do according to the Most High. This is not an open debate anymore. Either people listen to what the Most High say and understand what time we're in, or continue not believing. Okay? So we're going to put this out. And we're going to use mainstream media circulations, so that you cannot say that this is our opinion. And we're going to show you how this parallel directly to Scripture and history. We're going to go into the Josephus today, the Flavius Josephus, and show you how the Roman Empire conspired to destroy our people in Jerusalem. Let me tell you, brothers and sisters, we are not from Africa. Okay? Our homeland is Jerusalem. We fled into Africa, and now the Gentiles have assumed and pitched tent in our homeland. We moved into Africa, running from what? Roman persecution, just like Christ said we would. And I don't understand why Christians, those that follow Christ, will not take heed to the prophecy of the wilderness, of how Christ warned our people against imperialistic Rome. Let's go there first, and then I'm going to read these circulations here.
St. Luke chapter 21, verse 20.
Now, before you read that, one other point I want to say here, one other point I would like to make is concerning not only showing the children of Israel, but we're going to show you the people who are behind the conspiracy who have been destroying us according to the Most High, who know who we are, but purposely omit that particular information from education. Years ago, I put out a video. We put out a video through the Spirit of the Most High from Babylon, Rome to America. Okay, if you haven't seen it, you go look at that particular move, that particular video, and that video breaks down how the satanic plot against God's people moved from one empire to our present empire. Now, the difference is those that are running the empire now through secret societies understand who we are. They never lost that identity. They didn't go into slavery and lose their identity. So the secret societies hold what? The ancient wisdom. So if they're teaching ancient wisdom in secret societies, they must know who all the people are in the earth. It's just that those secret societies that control the earth, which is the Club of Rome, which are filled with Jewish people, will not tell the slaves that you are the children of Israel, that you are the people whom God gave the promise of Abraham to. Why? Because you are the enemy of Rome. Your existence shows a future prophecy. If you continue to live and have children, eventually your children will receive the promises that was given to them through bloodline. Now, of course, you must believe in Christ to receive those promises. But all in all, this is a bloodline promise. Not just to one whom believes, but to a specific bloodline. Now, let's read this according to Christ in Luke.
St. Luke chapter 21, verse 20. And when ye shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies.
So Christ told his people, the believers, which were Jews. Now, mind you, at this time, there was no mission to Gentiles. Now, I want to emphasize that. So who was Christ speaking to here? Hold and get Matthew 15 and 24, please.
St. Matthew chapter 15, verse 24.
Go ahead.
But he answered and said.
He answered and said.
I am not sent.
I am not sent.
But. Unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
Christ said, I was only sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So the mission to Gentiles was not established when Christ made the statement before his crucifixion. So let's see the statement he made to the house of Israel. Read.
I started St. Luke chapter 21, verse 19.
Go ahead.
In your patience, possess ye your souls.
It says, in your patience, possess ye your souls. That means you can't panic. You must use patience and wisdom with the understanding. Read.
Verse 20. And when you shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies.
When you shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies.
Then know that the desolation thereof is nigh.
Know that the desolation is near.
Then let them which are in Judea.
And the Jews which were living in Judea, the stock of Abraham living in Judea. Read.
Flee. To the mountains.
Flee to the mountains. So where did they flee? They flee into the Atlas Mountains around Africa, around Morocco, and eventually they went into Israel. Once certain parts was cut off, because certain areas was cut off by Moab and Ammon. So they had to go around the mountains of Morocco into Africa. Now, there's no history anywhere showing European Jewish people fleeing into Africa. So who are these Jews? Who are the people that fulfill this prophecy? The people who survived the siege and live and populated the Africa we know today. See that? Now all of them didn't stay over there. All of them didn't stay there. See? Some of them fulfilled this prophecy. And I'm saying this because I know we have people who are in the church, pastors who are listening, who follow the lessons. So we know that the children of Israel is in Africa, and that's why at the very end, they put up what? A black president. Not because he controlled anything. Barack Obama doesn't do anything. But he was the face that would be utilized so that the Western world, Rome, could come in and take down Africa and finish the siege that began with this prophecy. So that's why they're over there in Africa now under Africa. Not to help the Africans, to finish what the Romans didn't finish in 70 AD. Now, we, the children of those Africans, there was a prophecy that we would go into other places. Now the Most High scattered us in other places originally, you understand, based on the sins of our forefathers. He said that if we didn't listen, he would scatter Israel throughout the four corners of the earth. In a way, it became a saving grace because they couldn't destroy us all in one place. They would need to set up a new world order to identify us through bloodline and destroy us all at once because we were scattered. That's what the New World Order is about. That's what the One World Order is. Let's go to Deuteronomy 28 and let's read the 68th verse to show you that all would not stay in Africa, and we're just speaking of the Southern Kingdom here. When Christ was living, when he was on this earth, over 2,000 years ago, when he was on this earth, the southern kingdom was intact. Okay, the northern kingdom was taken out. The kingdom was split under Solomon. The northern kingdom was taken out almost 800 years before Christ. So there were some other people who were scattered, who had no idea who they were. And those were the people that the Roman the Roman imperialists, the Jesuits, found in the New World we called America. So they was already gone and scattered according to prophecy. But the last deluge happened right after Christ. So when this happened, when our people fled in Africa, we didn't stop in Africa. Because there was more prophecy concerning the children of Israel. Read Deuteronomy 28 and 68.
Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 68.
Go ahead.
And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships.
And that Egypt means bondage. Because there was no history of God's people going back into Egypt again by the means of slave ships. The children of Israel did not serve Egypt twice. So here's a future prophecy that you will go into Egypt, which means bondage. Hold that and get Exodus 13 and 3 to prove that.
Book of Exodus chapter 13, verse 3.
Go ahead.
And Moses said unto the people, remember this day in which he came out from Egypt.
Out from Egypt.
Out of the house of bondage.
Out of the house of bondage. So what is it saying in Deuteronomy 28 and 68? Thou shalt go into the house of bondage again by the means of what?
With ships.
With ships. See, that's the difference between in every culture having servitude and our captivity. We're talking about millions of people serving another nation. That never happened, no place in history, until the transatlantic slave ships. And who was behind the transatlantic slave ships? You got it. The Jewish powers, which are Roman. They are Roman. They are Khazars. Khazars come from the Caesars. Okay? They're just hiding themselves with a new assumed name. They are Edomites. They are Khazars. So the Most High said his people would go into what? Into Egypt, bondage a second time by the means of ships. Read.
By the way whereof I spake unto thee.
By the way wherein the Most High spake unto thee.
Thou shalt see it no more again.
Which means this captivity will be the last captivity. Israel will see no more captivity after this place of captivity, which means the Romans' time will soon be at an end. This is our last captivity, and they know it. So they must assume their last siege against us. See, this is a spiritual understanding that's been in the Bible the whole time. The same book that many of God's people are denying. You cannot deny those slave ships. I don't care who you think you are, whether you think you are an Egyptologist, whether you think you are this or that, whether you think you are a Muslim, whether you think you are a Christian, because guess what? Those slave ships wasn't divided on religious lines. There wasn't no part for the Egyptologists and for the Muslims. All of our foreparents had the same bloodline and suffered this same curse written of in the Bible. So whether you believe it or not, and I'm saying for those who don't believe the Bible, it doesn't matter if you know who you are according to the Most High. They're going to try to destroy you anyway because they know who you are according to the Most High. So if you don't cleave to your understanding as a way of refuge, it's to your own demise. Here's the prophecy. That thou shalt go into Egypt, slave ships, again by the way of what?
With ships.
With ships. Read.
By the way whereof I spake unto thee.
Go ahead.
Thou shalt see it no more again. And there you shall be sold unto your enemies.
And in this new land, you shall be sold unto your enemies. For what?
For bond men.
For a slave man.
And bond woman.
And a slave woman.
And no man shall buy you.
Which means no man shall redeem you out of your captivity. Why? Because Christ's blood is the only redeeming factor here. So no man within your captivity will pull you out of your slavery. Okay? The redemption comes through accepting Christ's blood. That buy means to redeem or buy something back. See that? Now, We know that according to scriptures that this happened not only from the Bible, but secular history records a fall of Jerusalem by the Romans. So my question is, who are those Romans? And who are those that were destroyed in 70 AD, which had a remnant of their people run into Africa against the face of the serpent people? Okay, I think we answered a few of those, but let's go. Let me go into some of this real-time news. And I'm going to parallel it, and then I'm going to go backwards into time to show you that this happened to us again. And because we don't understand who we are, we are doomed to repeat the same mistakes we made in the past. This is from the Washington Post. All right, I need you to go through it. Just read through it, and I'll speak as you go.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. I just printed the article, but go ahead.
Food stamps will get cut by $5 billion this week.
Food stamps will be cut by $5 billion this week.
And more cuts could follow.
Now, this will really affect the urban minority neighborhoods. Big time. This will affect who? This will affect the minority, the blacks, those that are on welfare, those that can't make ends meet. Now, you know, based on the recession and the bailouts and all that happened and all the jobs being outsourced outside the country, it's not that people don't want to work. There's just the jobs are drying up. So a lot of these people are going on welfare not because they don't want to work. There's no work. So they're trying to subsidize their income through government food. Now, these are the same people that's cutting this $5 billion who claim they love the children. In their propaganda. But who's going to be affected more than all the children that's not going to eat once they cut this program? But that's not the point that I'm making, because some people may say, well, there's many people, all races, on welfare. But if you look at the numbers and tear down the divisions of minorities that the government claim are minorities, and say, instead of saying that this is the Latinos and this is the black people and this is that and this is that, if you tear down those lines and look at the children of Israel as the people of Israel, the poor people that are suffering, that number, you understand? It's exponential. That means the majority of the people that's on this system are God's chosen people. They're the Israelites. The Latinos who were destroyed by the Romans, they're from the children of Israel. The North American Indians are from the children of Israel. The people that came in from Africa, they're from the children of Israel. So when you put these people all together, the majority of people that are on these EBT and food stamps are God's people. So what does that mean? Aren't they cutting $5 billion? I didn't hit it yet. I'm about to hit the point of this. But listen to this clearly. Read.
Mm-hmm. Food stamps will be cut by $5 billion this week.
$5 billion this week.
And more cuts could follow. This is by Brad Plummer, published October 28th. At 12:47 p.m.
Go ahead.
The U.S. food stamp program is set to shrink in the months ahead. The only real question is by how much. The Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program currently costs about $80 billion per year and provides food aid to 14% of all U.S. households, some 47 million people. Those numbers swelled dramatically during the recession. A farmer's market in Roseville, California, advertises its acceptance of EBT, or electronic benefit transfer cards, which are used for food stamps. A farmer's market in Roseville, California, jumping down, it says, but the food stamp program is now set to downsize in the weeks ahead. There's a big automatic cut scheduled for November 1st as a temporary boost from the 2009 stimulus bill expires.
Because the stimulus bill expired. A lot of you didn't know that that stimulus bill was temporary. It wasn't, they lied and claimed it was to upstart the economy. They lied. The stimulus package wasn't free money. It's over. Right? Reed?
That change will trim about $5 billion from federal food stamp spending over the coming year. And that's not all. The number of Americans on food stamps could drop even further in the months ahead, as Congress in various states contemplate further changes to the program. Here's a rundown. Number one, the end of the stimulus boost. First up is a big automatic cut to SNAP, scheduled for November 1st. This is happening because the food stamp program was temporarily expanded in 2009 as part of the Recovery Act. That bill spent $45.2 billion to increase monthly benefit levels to around $133 on average.
Now, before you go there, some people may ask, well, why are they doing this now? Why didn't they do this a long time ago? Well, they're doing it now because they have assumed their power over the earth and don't need the industrial workers within the United States anymore. They don't need the slaves anymore. They have built their grid. So what do they do with all these people they can't feed anymore? What they call wasteless eaters. See, they only had slaves to build their order, to fight in their wars, to build their systems, to build their country up. But there's nothing else to build. They went out in space like it was prophesied. So you have actually helped them fulfill their mission and to have their military go out in space and set their grid to fight against the coming of our Lord and Savior. So that's it. They don't need you. They went from the automotive thing to, they went from steam to automotive. They went and they was keeping you alive to build their military construct. That's it. They had everybody go to Detroit, move to Detroit for the car movement and all that and the automobiles. But what they didn't tell you, that that was just a front. That technology was being used so that they can actually build machines to go out in space and machines that would eventually fight and destroy you. Okay? So they sold you an image. They sold all of us an image. And while we were working there, we didn't understand that these jobs were temporal. Now that they have assumed the power over the earth, they don't need you. They can now go to a third world country and get servitude if they need that. But the American people are too high up. They're too free of thinkers. And the majority of God's people, with that freedom of free thinking, have learned the truth in that particular country. So now you are a threat to the New World Order. Okay, don't forget. Now, I won't deny anything. Listen, growing up, food stamps sustained all of us. Mm-hmm. So now the same people that are prophesying the fall of that country, they're looking at these same people whom they once fed. So it is like, listen, we got to pull back our, we have to starve these people out. The Most High is waking them up. So it's all out war. Listen to this clearly. Finish what you got there.
It says that bill spent about $45.2 billion to increase monthly benefit levels to around $133 on average.
Go ahead.
That bump will end on Friday. And benefits will shrink by around 5% on average.
So it's November 2nd now. Go ahead.
The Center of Budget and Policy Priorities has a short report calculating what this will mean for individual households. So, for instance, the maximum monthly benefit for a family of four will drop from $668 per month down to $632 per month. The maximum monthly benefit for an individual will drop from $200 per month to $189 per month. The cut is equivalent to about 16 meals a month for a family of three based on the cost of U.S. Agriculture Department's Thrifty Food Plan. Those snips add up. The end of the stimulus program will reduce federal food stamp spending by $5 billion in 2014. Every state will be affected. California, for instance, will see $457 million, drop in spending over the upcoming year, while Texas will lose $411 million as a result. Number two, Congress could cut food stamps even further.
See? They will, not could. Finish.
This stimulus lapse isn't the only cut on the horizon. This week, the House of Senate will resume their haggling over a five-year farm bill. The main point of contention, as before, is over how much to pare back the food stamp program. The Senate approved a farm bill that will make only minor changes to the food stamp program, saving $4.5 billion over 10 years. House Republicans, meanwhile, went even further, voting a bill that would...
Go ahead.
House Republicans, meanwhile, went even further, voting on a bill that would cut $39 billion from the...
$39 billion, go ahead.
From the program over 10 years.
Over 10 years. So what are they doing? They're slowly but surely cutting the food off from the people. Now, this is mainstream media. This is not our opinion. You don't got to read the whole thing. Mm-hmm. But this is straight from the Washington Post. Now, let's move over to Forbes now. Because while they're cutting $5 billion or $5 billion from the food rolls because they claim there's no money, the same $5 billion have been signed on to give Homeland Security more ammunition. So it's not that they have a lack of money. They're moving from food to ammunition. So now we understand what FEMA and all those, the Homeland Security, is ramping up the military for. For the people they're looking to starve out. And you're going to find out this happened before. And I'm going to show you in history. And because our people don't know that we're the children of Israel, you'll never understand why they're starving you out and looking to destroy you. So that's the importance of teaching the people who they are. So they'll know that there's a satanic plot to actually destroy them. Okay? You need to know, right? Let's read Forbes. What, you got something there? Mm-hmm. Let's
read. Before we move to the weapons, I want to stick on the food real quick. Going to the book of Isaiah chapter 3 verse 1.
Go ahead.
It says, "For behold, the Most High, the Lord of hosts, doeth take away from Jerusalem and from Judah the stay and the staff, the whole stay of bread and the whole stay of water."
The whole stay of what?
The whole stay of bread and the whole stay of water.
To show you that that's prophecy. That this is particularly aimed towards a people. Right? Now let's read Forbes.
This is Forbes.
Now, how is it you don't have the money to give people food, which they need, but have the money to spend the same $5 billion on ammunition? That doesn't make any sense to it. You people can't eat bullets. And not only that, these bullets they're buying are hollow point. And they know exactly how it works. No sooner the food is taken out, the people began to operate or steal from each other. And therefore, you'll call for government intervention. And that's when the killing starts. That's the plan. Let's starve them out. A couple of weeks ago, they cut off the EPTs, claiming it was a glitch in the system, just to see the reaction from the slaves. See? Now, that also leads us to the pastors and preachers, which are in the churches, these mega churches now that have been teaching prosperity. What happens when now all the food is cut off and all these poor people who've been giving you all this money, what happens when they come to you for answers and ask and start asking, where's our prosperity? I know you have an answer through your 501c3. And the answer is, well, you must take the mark of the beast. That's the next system that's coming in. And that's why they're transitioning, first using the welfare system as a beta test for the worldwide mark of the beast system. So that's what they'll have for you next. That's why they took out all your private little churches and absorbed it into the New World Order churches, the mega churches. They'll have an answer for you. You will eat after bowing to Satan. Right? And I'm talking about those that will take the mark of the beast. But we know that those that follow Christ, that follow the Most High God, are the majority of the people they're aiming this destruction towards. And even you that take the mark of the beast, you will only live for a short number of years until they see no use for you anymore. Okay? Let's read this about the rounds here.
It says 1.6 billion rounds of ammo for Homeland Security.
For Homeland Security. I thought Homeland Security was to find Bin Laden. No. It had nothing to do with that. Read.
It's time for a national conversation.
It's time for a national conversation. Let's go down here.
It says the Denver Post on February 15th ran an Associated Press article entitled Homeland Security aims to buy 1.6 billion rounds of ammo. So far, little to notice. It confirmed that the Department of Homeland Security has raised or has issued an open purchase ordered for 1.6 billion rounds of ammunition. As reported elsewhere, some of this purchase ordered is for hollow point rounds.
Hollow point rounds. And a lot of you might not know what hollow point rounds are. Hollow points are kill weapons. They go in, they enter the body and explode. I mean, you can shoot any part of the body and kill someone with a hollow point. Even if you shoot them in a leg, it'll just blow and blow an artery. So hollow points are kill shots. So what are they preparing for? They're not buying these hollow points for nothing. 1.6 billion by Homeland Security, knowing that they would soon take away the rations of food. See? And don't tell me about the elected officials. The elected officials, don't look at them. They can't do anything. Okay? They're just there ceremonial to make you believe you have representation. Okay? And they have already convinced these guys, say, listen, don't worry about what we're going to do to them. We're going to do something. We're going to show shelter for your family if you play ball, or we'll take you out too. That's how the game is played, brothers and sisters. Okay. America is not being ran by politicians in America. Those that control the money controls the system. Okay. And the money is not being controlled within America. Even those that are over the Federal Reserve, which is actually a religious institution under Zionism, it's not being controlled from America. Think about this. People only look to get dual citizenship when there's a chance where they're living at will not exist. And by default, every Jewish person in America qualifies for dual citizenship. By being Jewish born, you automatically have dual citizenship to get out of the country anytime you need. That's not afforded to the real Jews. So something is going on, right? Finish reading.
It says, some of this purchase order is for hollow point rounds.
Go ahead.
Forbidden by international law for use in war.
So you are not allowed to use these particular bullets in war against a foreign country. But they're buying them for United States citizens. Read.
Along with a frightening amount specialized for snipers. Also reported elsewhere, at the height of the Iraq war, the army was expending less than 6 million rounds a month.
Go ahead.
Therefore, 1.6 billion rounds would be enough to sustain a war for 20 plus years in America.
Mm. Oh, they told you it was Al-Qaeda. It was Al-Qaeda. They told you it was Bin Laden. These fictitious characters. So that you can be behind America all the way. USA! Yeah, USA! Not knowing that you are the target between the crosshairs. The whole time. Because if you can agree with anyone to go into another country and kill their children, then you should know Galatians 6 and 7 says what goes around comes around. That eventually, if they are okay with killing these people, then all right, it should be okay to kill you. That's their mindset. Listen to this clearly. Go ahead.
Add to this perplexing outtrade purchase of ammo, DHS now is showing off its acquisition.
Go ahead.
Of heavily armored personnel carriers.
Heavy armored personnel carriers. Now, speaking of heavy armored personnel carriers, I know a lot of you probably wanted to know, well, how will they initiate this martial law, because that's what it is, this military imposition within the country, within the urban areas. Well, right now there's a project at the same time that they have cut the food and ramped up the same $5 billion for ammunition. Mm-hmm. They have a drill going on called Project Urban Shield that started in California, in which they're claiming now, and they're using the same military vehicles that's spoken of through Homeland Security, they're claiming that they have to shut down a whole region, a whole neighborhood, looking for one guy. And you know they can do this in every neighborhood where the CIA have established their drug hub. They know who the drug dealers are. So what are they doing now? They're using Project Urban Shield to now disarm and take out the gangs with guns. Because that will be their first opposition before they come after the people. Those that already have guns. See? So they got the false flags going on where they're claiming that people are shooting things up to take guns from the law-abiding citizens. And now they use an urban shield to go in and take the guns from the same people the CIA gave it to demoralize and destroy our people. So those that are drug dealers and gang bangers and want to be thugs, they're coming after you. That's what Project Urban Shield is. And not just you, they're going to use you as a pretext to impose their will on your family and all those that live in your neighborhoods. Same time, you think it's a coincidence? We're right here. And based on where we're going and what we're seeing, I'll be hard-pressed to think on whether or not there'll be another election. Because you cannot elect a president under the law, midstream, through martial law into total chaos. Listen to this clearly. Go ahead.
It says, DHS is now showing off its acquisition of heavily armored personnel carriers repatriated from the Iraqi and Afghani theaters of operation. As observed by paramilitary blogger Ken Jorgensen last summer, NRA winning the influence battle over gun control, Bruce Rogers, Ford staff. Obama's gun control laws would limit, do not destroy or not destroy $32 billion firearm industry, Abram Brown. A gun control battle that could actually damage the industry is escaping public attention. I'll jump it down. It says the Department of Homeland Security is apparently taking delivery, apparently through the Marine Corps Systems Command, Quantico, Virginia, via the manufacturer, Navistar Defense, of an undetermined number of the recently retrodified 2,717 mine-resistant protected MaxPro MARP vehicles for service on the streets of the United States.
On the streets of the United States. And I never forget teaching on the street and say, brothers and sisters, you're going to look up, there are going to be tanks rolling down the street. I remember that like it was yesterday. People just going to the mall, relaxing, having fun, going to meet people at the mall. I'm like, listen, tanks will be rolling down these streets. Now they have done major construction on the whole, all the highways throughout the United States to make it able ready. Not for easy access travel, but for military travel. And they've already put the checkpoints in place with the DUI checkpoints. It have nothing to do with drunken while being under the influence. It have everything to do with what they're putting in place to actually crush God's people. Read.
These MARPs are being seen on U.S. streets all across America by verified observers with photos, videos, and descriptions. Regardless of the exact number of MARPs being delivered to DHS, and evidently some to police via DHS, as has been observed, why would they need such over-the-top vehicles on U.S. streets?
Why do they need military vehicles on United States roads? Read.
To withstand IEDs.
To withstand IEDs. Think about that. Like, who had the equipment to fight the military? Who would be shooting things that would try to blow over a tank? Read.
Mine blast and 50 caliber hits to bulletproof glass.
Another thing, it don't bulletproof glass. What? Another thing, to show you that it's against those that fled into the wilderness. It's against the children of Israel. The mall that blew up in Kenya, it was owned by a partner of the same guy that owned the World Trade Center. So the same plans they have over within the United States, they're now moving into Africa. So don't think it's a coincidence that there's a Kenyan connection and they claim that Barack Obama's father was from Kenya. So they needed that face to go into that country to continue the siege that began in 70 AD. And I'm going to talk about that siege in one moment, because that's the same thing. It's the Romans against the children of Israel, and we are in the final siege. And I'm going to tell you, brothers, I'm going to say it again. It doesn't matter if you believe that the Bible is true or not. I know one thing, the prophecies in the Bible are true. And I know this, that when Christ told our people that when you shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, flee into the mountains, that the people that didn't believe the Most High word was true through Christ was destroyed. So the Most High is gracious enough to at least sound the trumpet and give you ample warning. Now, whether or not you want to believe in the Bible is another thing. But I know this, that we're definitely living the prophecies of the Bible. What I'm reading is like history repeating itself over again. And while our people just walking around and shopping and operating like everything is fine. And I know, listen, a lot of us, now that it's getting a little chilly, We're going to go into Christmas mode now. They got us programmed like gerbils or rats or monkeys or something. We're going to totally ignore that they are ramping up war against us and go into Christmas mode. Read on.
I'm going to jump down. It states, why indeed? It is utterly inconceivable that the Department of Homeland Security, Janet Napolitano, is planning a coup d'etat against President Obama and the Congress to install herself as supreme ruler of the United States of America. There, however, are real signs that the department bureaucrats are running amok. About 20 years ago, this columnist worked for 2 years in the U.S. Department of Energy's General Counsel's office in its procurement of financial division and of financial division, and is wise to the ways. The answer to why the DHS needs such a vehicle almost certainly is this: it's a cool toy, and these reportedly million-dollar toys are being recycled with much of an impact on the DHS budget. So why not? Why, indeed, should the federal government not be deploying armored personnel carriers and stockpiling enough ammo for a 20-year war in the homeland? Because it's wrong in every way. President Obama has an opportunity now to live up to some of his rhetoric by helping the federal government set a noble example in a matter very close to his heart and that of his progressive base.
Okay, so now we're going into the propaganda that comes with mainstream media, as if Barack Obama could do something about this and Forbes magazine. He can't do nothing. Okay, he can play his role. He don't control anything. Your mayor don't control anything. Your city council don't control anything. They get the memos and follow the agenda. Why do you think that when the president come in, they brief him on what he'll do for the whole year? They brief him on all his appointments. He don't make no appointments. They brief them because why? The status quo and the program leading to the New World Order have been already etched out from one president to the next. You just go in and play your role and get photo ops. That's it. So I don't blame Barack Obama for anything. He's doing what he do. He's getting paid to play the ceremonial part of being a president, so that the people can think they have representation while the puppet masters control from the top, from another country someplace. And when it all falls, and guess what? Netanyahu even said it. He said, we're going to squeeze America for all it have and then blow it away. That's Netanyahu, the president of Israel, saying, telling you that the country, America, is expendable. He's going to use the poor of our people to fight his wars. He's going to use the military might within the United States to fight his wars. And now he's going to turn it internally, because now the same people that control America's military also controls the UN military. That's where we are. Now let's go to the next phase of this. And I got this off of, this is off InfoWars here, about the food. Read here, the Federal Emergency Management.
It says, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, or FEMA, is contacting storable food suppliers requesting immediate delivery of food reserves within a 24-hour period. Increasing suspicions that the federal government is accelerating its preparations for social disorder or an environmental calamity.
Now, this was published when?
August 6th.
August 6th. That means if they purchased this food in August 6th or near in August, they knew that the food would be cut in November. See? Starting to make sense to you now? Read.
FEMA recently contacted My Patriot Supply, a full provider of bulk food reserves, requesting immediate delivery of truckloads of food within a 24-hour period, instead of soliciting for the food in the normal manner via the Federal Business Opportunities website and thereby saving money, FEMA is now directly contacting suppliers in order to secure overnight deliveries of bulk food. The snapshot above shows one of the emails My Patriot Supply received from FEMA. While it's certainly not unusual for FEMA to be buying storable food, the rushed manner which the federal agency is now conducting such business has raised a few eyebrows, prompting the owner of My Patriot Supply to ask, why the sudden sense of urgency? What do they know that we do not? I'm not one to cry that the sky is always falling, but when the DHS/FEMA make a move to quietly buy up emergency food supplies and ask how much we can ship within 24 hours, I think this is far enough outside the realm of what is normal to beg some questions, remarked the company's owner.
Now, so let's run this down. There's no funding for schooling. All the schools, especially in the urban neighborhoods, are to be shut down or cut all together. Finances cut for education. So the buildings are still there. Now, mind you, these same buildings were turned into what? Many processing places when they claimed there was too much crime in the neighborhoods and started putting what? Metal detectors and all types of prisoner type of apparatuses in these particular buildings. But now the schools are shutting down with the same technology still in the buildings. So what is this telling you? That's telling you that these buildings, which we call schools, will be processing plants for the fusion centers. See? They purchased the food. Emergency food for an emergency situation for those that come inside these particular fusion centers. Not for the normal population. They expect the normal areas, especially the inner cities, to be totally chaotic and uncontrollable. So the food is not to bring food to stabilize the cities. The food is for those that make it into the fusion centers. So when you go to church and we go to all these other places for answers, they're going to direct you through Rite Aid to seek shelter in the fusion centers, like they did through Hurricane Sandy. That's what's going on. They're not going to look to stabilize the cities. As a matter of fact, they're going to finish tearing down the cities more and more and more so that they can utilize international intervention. So happened the other day to look at blackout. They've shown on National Geographic what happens if the lights go out for a week, since the electric is on the internet grid. Suppose a hacker get in and mess up the electric when they know it have nothing to do with hackers at all. Who would risk putting your livelihood in the workings of your whole country? Who would risk putting it on a grid that can be hacked? That could get hacked. They're letting you know that in the midst of all this, they're going to cut off electricity too. So the question is why? We know what's going on. Is this in the Bible? Is this prophecy? Did this happen before? I'm going to hit some notes here. You have your Josephus? Your particular one here? All right. The New Complete Works of Josephus. I'm going to go into some history. Josephus was an Israelite. He was a Jew who was hired under the Roman Empire to record the actions of our people that lived in Jerusalem during the time of the deluge or the fall in 70 AD. Now, a lot of our people can't even relate to 70 AD because you weren't taught that you were the people that fell by the Roman Empire. A lot of you don't even know about 70 AD. Right? Someone just sent me something. I don't usually go through that, but it links directly to what we're speaking of. He says, there's a school called Merget Park in the inner city that have been shut down for almost 6 years. And 4 weeks ago, the state troopers have been meeting there every day. See? It's not as if these buildings and a lot of these buildings are so-called going on sale to the private sector. Who's buying these places up, these schools that will be shut down? These are actually processing plants for the population. All right? So it's all-out war. That's what's going on here, and this happened to us before. Let's go to the war against the Jews, which are written of in Josephus. And I need you to start at the 12th chapter, and let's start at the first verse in the 12th chapter.
Mm-hmm. This is Josephus' War Against the Jews, Book 5, Chapter 12, Paragraph 1.
Go ahead.
And now did Titus consult with his commanders what was to be done. Those that were of the warmest tempers thought that he should bring the whole army against the city and storm the wall. For that hitherto no more than a part of their army had fought with the Jews, but that in case the entire army was to come at once.
So first Titus planned to just bring his army against our people all at once. That was the plan. But if you do that, you rally the population against you. That wasn't smart, right? So he got some advice. Listen clearly.
But that in case the entire army was to come at once, they would not be able to sustain their attacks, but would be overwhelmed by their darts. But of those that were of a more cautious management, some were for raising their banks again, and others observed to let the bank alone, but to lie still before the city, to guard against the coming out of the Jews and against their carrying provisions into the city, and so to leave the enemy to the famine, and this without direct fighting with them, for that despair was not to be conquered.
Listen to this clearly. So they came up with another plan. We can do this another way and not lose men. Let's just encampus around that, the areas they're in, and don't let any food in or out. And don't allow them to come out to get food. See? If you go in against them initially, you do what? You cause them to, in their fullest strength, they're healthy now. They can fight against you. They got food. But if you sit back and cut off their food and weaken them, see, that's a war tactic. Oh, yeah, EBTs, because of the stimulus package is discontinued, we're just going to slow up on EBTs and not feed the people. Right? But really, the whole plan is to first cut off your resources before they come against you. And then allow that crab in the bucket mentality to develop amongst you to fight over the little bit you have first. Mm-hmm. See? This way, they can allow you to fight and destroy yourself, and then take out who's left. This happened in 70 AD, brothers and sisters. So first of all, they would claim, well, let's make a border to keep people out. Let me tell you, people are not trying to come outside, come in America. The matter of fact, the Mexicans and all of them are trying to get out and go back home. And they're trying to stop them from going back home. So the first thing is to make you think that someone is coming into your country to take your jobs when there is no jobs to take. But they're setting up borders not to keep people from coming in, but to keep those who are the target of Satan's destruction from getting out. Listen to this clearly.
Mm-hmm. Let me read this real quick out of St. Luke chapter 19, verse 43 through 44.
Go ahead.
For the day shall come upon thee, that thine enemy shall cast a trench about thee.
That your enemy shall cast a trench about thee, which is borders,
And compass thee round about.
And compass thee round about.
And keep thee in on every side.
And keep thee in on every side. Christ told them what was going to happen. But you know, there was many people back then saying, I'm not following Christ. Who wrote that? But now we're reading the history that was recorded, that the Most High allowed to be recorded, so that those in the future will understand that there's an enemy that's looking to utterly destroy you. They did it before, and they will accomplish it on a world scale in our time. But of course, there's an escape for the elect who understand. This is not to fear. We know what they're going to do. The Bible told us what they was going to do years ago. So we're not afraid of what they're doing. We're just showing you there's a war against you. And we need to cleave back to our God, our Creator, the power that have placed us in this position. Not to be destroyed, but to cleave to the power. To cleave to the Most High and succeed and overcome the wiles and traps of the devil. There is an escape. Okay, and it's deeper than geographical location displacement. That just buys time. Finish reading.
44. And shall lay thee even with the ground, and thy children within thee, and they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another, because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation.
Because you didn't know it was the time of your visitation. So all these distractions in the world, they have us focusing on all these other things that are going on, especially with the distraction box called TV. Not realizing a deluge is prepared. A desolation is prophesied. So here it is. Instead of just sending the armies all against Jerusalem, which were our foreparents in Israel, all at once, they say, well, listen, let's just put a garrison around, of armies around, which is your border control. And let's not let anyone get in or out. And we can control their consumption. So now that our people have been so dependent on the EPTs and food stamps, when they start pulling that away from you, and then through chaos, the trucks and all the other resources that you would normally get cannot come into your cities based on this martial law and confusion, this urban shield, then how will you eat? And this is something that can't be prayed away. And I'm going straight to the churches now. Say, well, just have faith. Food is not going to fall from the sky because you believe. Because you think you believe when you're not believing and preparing with the faith contained in the Bible. We're not talking magic here. So all the churches out there, they have to move their doctrine from prosperity to preparation. Leave all those mega churches and get back into your small units to prepare, to help each other like we did back then. Creflo Dollar, all these guys are going to be on their jets out someplace. And those same buildings that they have made, these mega churches, will also be used as processing plants for the fusion centers. They weren't built so you can praise God, okay? Finish reading.
It says, however, Titus did not think it fit for so great an army to lie entirely idle, and that yet it was vain to fight with those that would be destroyed one by another. He also showed them how impracticable it was to cast up any more banks for want of materials and to guard against the Jews coming out.
So let's guard against the Jews coming out. Listen, we're the Jews. Not according to religion or conversion, through bloodline, through prophecy. We are God's people. It's just that the Khazars, who are now claiming to be Jews, have educated us. They have taken our identity and called us Ham and taught that in their institutions under the Jesuit order of the Catholic Church. We're Israelites. So this aim had been towards us the whole time. And they had to do this. They had to slowly destroy us. Because we're we're strong, number one, physically strong. And there's too many of us in number. And they are afraid that if we come together, we will call on one God and assume our rightful positions as leaders of this earth. So what did they do? During the Civil Rights Movement, which was a prominent part of history within the United States, they seen how much power men like Martin Luther King had, who had more status amongst our people than the President of the United States. They took him out and then started setting up handouts under the Civil Rights Movement, claiming that they're making reparations or trying to even the playing field for those who are children of slaves. So welfare was not first promoted as an entitlement. It was a way to balance the inequality within the United States. See? Because they were paying us less than white people. So they say, well, we're going to subsidize you by giving you more food. That's where that came. That was the initial reason for the program. It wasn't no entitlement. But they use that and say, you know what? Let's take this system and let's set up the mark of the beast with it. Let's get the man out of the home and control the families and the future mindsets of the family with this system and make it where now they're no longer dependent on themselves as a strength like they were in the 60s. Now they are dependent on the same government that's looking to destroy them. See? It happened before. Remember when they gave up Christ? And says, listen, he claimed to be king, Caesar, when there's no king but you, Caesar. See? Rejected our king, some of our people, for Caesar. That's what's happening with the preachers in 501c3 selling out to the government. And then when everything was said and done, the same people whom our leaders over the Sanhedrin was honoring because he was giving them a little cash for a time. The same Caesar line family destroyed us in 70 AD. Caesar is not for us. He never was. Caesar is a Satan worshiper. They're the serpent people. Okay, finish reading.
Still more impracticable, as also that to encompass the whole city round with his army was not very easy, by reason of its magnitude and difficulty of the situation, and on other accounts dangerous, upon the sallies of the Jews might make out of the city. For although they might guard the known passages out of the place, yet would they, when they found themselves under the greatest distress, contrive secret passages out, as being well acquainted with all such places. And if any provisions were carried in by stealth, the siege would thereby be longer delayed. He also owned that he was afraid that the length of time thus to be spent would diminish the glory of his success. For though it be true that length of time will perfect everything, yet that to do what we do in a little time is still necessary to gaining reputation. That therefore his opinion was that if they aimed at quickness joint with security, they might build a wall round
security. Doesn't that sound familiar? National security. See, this is history I'm reading here. Now, a lot of you who, I'm talking to people who may run into this and don't believe the Bible. The siege that Christ prophesied, I'm reading about in history, in a history book that's recorded under Romans canon. This happened. Read.
It says, yet, it says, for though it be true that the length of time will perfect everything, yet that to do what we do in a little time is still necessary to the gaining reputation. That therefore his opinion was that if they aimed at quickness joint with security, they must build a wall round about the whole city, which he thought the only way to prevent the Jews from coming out anyway, and that then they would either entirely despair of saving the city, and so would surrender it up to him.
Checkpoints. Go ahead.
Or be still the more easily conquered with the famine, when the famine had further weakened them, for that besides this wall, he would not entirely rest afterward, but would take care of them to have banks raised again, when those that would oppress or oppose them would become weaker. But that if anyone should think such a work to be too great and not to be finished with much difficulty, he ought to consider that it is not fit for the Romans to undertake any small work, and that none but the Most High himself could with ease accomplish any great thing whatsoever.
So these Romans were very patient. And look at how they did this. They entrenched, and they say, you know what? We're going to cut off their food, make them weak. They knew how strong we were, and they know how strong we are. See, if they came against us all at once and saying, listen, we're the Edomite Romans looking to destroy you with these Roman armies that are now pitching tent all in your country, we would all rally together. I don't care if you are an Egyptian, Egyptology. I don't care if you waving a Puerto Rican flag. I don't care if you jumping around a totem pole on the reservation. If they was to come against you to physically destroy you for the sake of self-preservation, you would all join together in one mind for self-preservation. That's why they can't come at you like that. Christ told us a nation divided against itself cannot stand. So they had to first break us down in groups and make us believe we were something different than what God called us to be, the children of Israel. That was part of their war. And then play us off against each other, while planting a garrison or a border around us that would soon mean our demise. Stop them from getting out. Stop them from operating freely. Set up checkpoints. Cut off their food. Read.
I'm going to jump down to paragraph 3.
Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. So all hope of escaping was now cut off.
All hope of escaping was cut off.
From the Jews.
From the Jews.
Together with their liberty of going out of the city.
They could no longer go in and out of the city anymore. Go ahead.
Then did the famine widen its progress.
Then the famine widened its progress. Now the famine, the cutoff, the EBT, and all those things they're cutting off is now taking effect now. Because there's no new food coming in. So if there's another disaster that happens, that will impede or stop trucks and all that from coming into your neighborhoods bringing food. Right? So they already know the process of what happens by doing this. They've done it before. They've done it. They've done this. See that? So they know the progression. They know what happens once they stop travel and won't allow food to get in after cutting off food. They know that it makes people weak. They know that it will cause people to start fighting against each other internally first. Listen to this. And this is where the hollow points come in at. Read.
Then did the famine widen its progress and devoured the people by whole houses and families. The upper rooms were full of women and children that were dying by famine. And the lanes of the city were full of dead bodies of the aged. The children also...
That means the elderly. Because look how much... The elderly is on food stamps too. Mm-hmm. So it says eventually the streets were filled with the aged, our people dying. Now today, they got a normal euthanization program that if you now you're sick or you're elderly, they take you into one of these institutions and they will just kill you off through euthanization, which is another, which is a Greek word for death. They'll claim you came down with pneumonia or something, put you on morphine, slowly stop your heart and have your family come pray over you, put them in the ground. Okay, that's the way they do it now. It's a more politically correct way of killing you, but nonetheless, same result. Right? Read.
It says, the children also and the young men wandered about the marketplaces like shadows, all swelled with the famine, and fell down dead wheresoever their misery seized them. It says, as for burying them, those that were sick themselves were not able to do it, and those that were hearty and well were deterred from doing it by the great multitude of those dead bodies.
Now, in the midst of these things, and you notice that if you got dead in a large number, you have what you call diseases. So now, in the midst of all this, they're pushing throughout government all over the world pandemics. They showed on the blackout thing through National Geographic, I seen, some guy went down in the basement and opened some body bags that had contamination bodies on it. So this is all in the midst of this, a pandemic, food shortage, army coming against you. So I'm just paralleling, and I'm just trying to illustrate that when the Bible says there's nothing new under the sun, there's nothing new under the sun. We're going into the same prophecies again. And it's still aimed against the same people, even though you don't know that the war is against you. And one of the main weapons I see that Satan been using is infighting. And you know what? I'm not even going to deal with it no more. I'm not people trying to talk and say something against it. Well, this ain't right. That ain't right. Listen, keep on going. I will not respond. I will not respond anymore. Okay? Look at what the Most High is saying is going on. Believe that. Another distraction is infighting. Read on.
And those that were hardy and well deterred from doing it, by the great multitude of those dead bodies, and by the uncertainty there was how soon they should die themselves. For many died as they were burying others, and many went to their coffins before that fatal hour was come. Nor was there any lamentation made under these calamities, nor were heard any mournful complaints, but the famine confounded all natural passions. For those who were just going to die looked upon those that were gone to their rest before them with dry eyes and open mouths. A deep silence also, a kind of deadly night, had seized upon the city, while yet the robbers were still more terrible than these miseries were themselves. For they break open the houses.
Now here come those young thugs who are not fighting the Romans. Mm-hmm. They're coming in now and seeing the weakness of our people, and now they're looting. Sound familiar? Let's go back not too many years ago to the dome in New Orleans. People looting. They think this is an opportunity to come up, that soon the light's going to come on and everything is going to be all right. But when the lights do come on, I'm going to have all this stuff. So people are dying, total chaos, and you're going to have a demographic of the people, of the poor, running around trying to get stuff. Robbing people. Same thing happened in 70 AD. So they know the progression. They understand this. The Romans did it before. They did it to us before. And I'm talking about people going around. Here it is. Someone is waiting on the outside to destroy you. And you're there looking at the famine, looking at the total destruction, running around trying to get paid and raping women and all that. It happened to us before. And guess what? It happened to the Jews, the Israelites. And this predominantly happened to the people who didn't take heed to Christ's prophecy when he says, when you shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, flee into the mountains. And I'm going to tell you this, and it's a dichotomy to me, that the people whom the Bible is speaking of is not even taking heed to this. It's the Gentiles, just by normal watching and observing society, is going into the spirit of bugging out, trying to find contingency places in case something happens. And the prophecies don't even, it's not even related to them. But they see that something is coming. They understand something is coming. So they're like, listen, I'm going to make sure we, you know, there's a contingency plan to bug out. And these people don't even believe the Bible. They don't even believe. A lot of these, they just understand society and what happens within society. And they plan accordingly. Right? So what did the brothers do? Now they're robbing people now.
It says, for they break open those houses which were no other than graves of dead bodies.
Gangs. Read.
And plundered them of what they had.
So they started robbing dead people's graves. Robbing in the houses. Taking their rings. Taking their necklaces. Gangs. Right? Read.
And carrying off the coverings of their bodies, went out laughing.
Had no respect for the dead. Went out laughing. Now see, this is our people. See, they know how we operate. Don't tell me this is not us. Read.
And try the points of their swords.
And see, and no sooner as they do these things, no sooner they start cutting off the food, the enemies under Satan will have cameras in certain areas saying, look at them. Mm-hmm. They're suffering and they're running around like animals trying to steal things. And that's the propaganda they need to get the sentiments from the world to come against us. See? They know no sooner as the lights go out, our people start doing something that's counterproductive. That will only ramp up the destruction against us. See? That's how it works. When I read this, I can just, only thing that's coming to my mind is natural disaster, FEMA. This is what this is. And the Romans knew that we would do this. They knew it. And now we don't have to lose any men in war immediately. They already allowed us to become their military. We just encamp around them and just snipe those that try to come out of the city and make sure no food or water gets in or out. Okay? Because we can't take them all at once because there's too many of them. They will overtake us. So we weren't planning all together while we were healthy how to overcome the Romans on the outside of us. Okay, we were sitting back saying, well, yeah, you know, I'm just going to have a little faith. The Most High never forsake us. He protect us coming out of Egypt. We got food here. Everything is okay. It'll be all right. And the Romans were patient. They waited. They waited. They waited. See? By the time you understand the plan, it's too late. By the time it kicks in of how what they're doing will impact you, it's already over. What was the next step here?
It says, and tried the points of their swords on their dead bodies. And in order to prove what metal they were made of, they thrust some of those through that still lay alive on the ground.
Gangs. These are gangs operating. Thugs. And I can see these cats walking around today, all tatted up, guns around. And here it is. The people on the outside is your real enemy. And because there's no rule of law amongst you, you're acting like a tyrant against your own. See, this is what happens. I'm just paralleling to prove to you we must be these same people. The plan is ramped up against us. They're doing their part. They're doing the will of their father. I'm talking about the Romans. They're doing their part. They're setting it exactly how the Caesars set it against us in 70 AD. But what are we doing? And guess what? I'm going to say it again to the churches. You are not going to pray this away. It ain't going to happen. Let's go over here.
Mm-hmm. This is War of the Jews, Book 5, Chapter 13, Paragraph 4. Hereupon, some of the deserters, having no other way, leaped down from the wall immediately, while others of them went out of the city with stones, as if they would fight them. But thereupon they fled away to the Romans, but here a worse fate accompanied these than what they had found within the city. And they met with a quicker dispatch from the two greater abundance they had among the Romans than they could have done from the famine among the Jews. For when they first came to the Romans, they were puffed up by the famine and swelled like men in a dropsy. After which they all had sudden overfilled those bodies that were before empty, and so burst asunder, excepting such only as were skillful enough to restrain their appetites, and by degrees took in their food into bodies unaccustomed thereto. Yet did another plague seize upon those that were thus preserved, for there were found among the Syrian deserts, or deserters, a certain person who was caught gathering pieces of gold out of the excrements of the Jews' bellies. For the deserters used to swallow such pieces of gold, as we told you before, when they came out. For these did the seditious search them all.
So what was going on is, for those who was trying to escape, they, in hope of not getting robbed of their purse, they swallowed the gold and hoping to, through their waste, go through their waste and get the gold later. Trying to smuggle it out and have some resources to operate. Now, check this out. And you notice how now, if you try to get on a plane or you try to travel someplace, they limit the amount you can take with you. So even back then, if you had something on your purse, you had these guys running around robbing people. You couldn't. So they would just swallow the gold and hope to get loose someplace and then waste it out and use the gold later. Because why? In order for you to get from one place to the next, you need some barter power. You need some finances. They didn't want to get robbed by their own brethren. So some of them who escaped swallowed the gold, but died on the way once they escaped through. So what happens? They would, you had the army and others cutting them open, and others cutting them open, looking for gold in their bellies, knowing that if they was going to escape and didn't have a purse, they probably swallowed the gold. Now let's transition this up till today. Now they setting up the electronic system where you can't travel freely. Your money is electric now. And they, to get gold and silver is frowned upon. But in an emergency, what good will it be in this scenario? See? So it's the same thing again. It's full circle. 70 AD again. We're in it. We're at the end of desolations. This is the final siege. But first, the first stage is setting up the border. Second stage, cutting off food, EBT. The third stage, internal rioting and looting amongst the people. And then the fourth stage, crushed, sacked. That's it. Those are the four stages. What stage are we in now? We're in the stage of the food being taken away, which will weaken the population. They've already got the cities set up. They already got the borders established. It's already there. They already have the garrison around each city in each country, around the whole country through border control. Next stage is the rioting. And see, it's going to be a little, well, let's go. I don't want to go there. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. It says, but when the contrivance was discovered in one instance, the fame of it filled their several camps, that the deserters came to them full of gold. So the multitude of the Arabians with the Syrians cut up those that came as supplicants and searched their bellies.
Searched their bellies. So now the other people, if we died in the wilderness or whatever the case is in certain areas, the other nations was ripping us open looking for gold. We couldn't carry it on our person. Read.
Nor does it seem to me that any misery befell the Jews that was more terrible than this, since in one night's time, about 2,000 of these deserters were thus dissected. When Titus came to the knowledge of this wicked practice, he had like to have surrounded those that had been guilty of it with his horse and have shot them dead. And he had done it, had not the number been so very great. And those that were liable to this punishment would have been manifold, more than those whom they had slain. However, he called together the commanders of the auxiliary troops he had with him, as well as the commanders of the Roman legions, for some of his own soldiers had been also guilty herein, as he had been informed, and had great indignation against both sorts of them, and spoke to them as follows.
Now there's another instance here. There's an instance in which the same looters going through Masada bust open the door and seen a sister cooking the other half of her baby. The baby was roasted. And they took the baby because that's all the food that was left. She was cooking her own child that died through the famine. So we're in the final desolation. I want to read something real quick. Need you to go where it talks about the prince and Daniel. The prince of the people.
The book of Daniel, chapter 9, verse 26.
Daniel's 9. To show you what people are behind this conspiracy against the children of Israel to destroy them, to cut them off, then destroy them all together. And I'm going to put this out there to all people who don't believe that we are God's people. And I'm speaking specifically to our people that are out there berating the Bible. Okay? If you are an Egyptologist and don't believe in the Bible, tell me how you being from Egypt is going to help you through this deluge. how is that going to help you through what's being prepared? If you don't believe in the Bible in which this is written, showing you what is to come to pass, then what is the answer when they come against all of our people in the inner cities? How you being from Egypt helps you. Let's talk to those who don't believe in the Bible and are following the Quran and of our people that claim that they're Muslims. How does this help you? If you're a Muslim following Islam, how does the Quran help you? When the Quran can't even help the people in the Middle East that are being destroyed now. How does that help you when they come against you? Where's your refuge? Where is it prophesied in your records that this would happen? And what to do once it happened? Once it happens. Only those who believe in Christ made it past 70 AD. See? Get where we're going here. You must link to the spirit, the faith of our God. We must link to the faith of our God that have placed us in this condition for the answer. And that's the importance of understanding who you are. Now, for those who are not Hebrews or Israelites that believe in Christ and believe in the truth, what part do you have? How does this relate to you, you might ask? Well, because we've been scattered amongst you all, the powers will destroy you too, in fear that you've probably mixed amongst us. So you have to cleave to Christ and come to the truth, and you must be a help in the day of trouble for God's people. Okay? Because you're in it, whether you like it or not. Let's read it.
Daniel 9:26.
Go ahead.
And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city.
Hold up. The people of the prince shall come and destroy the city. Read.
And destroy the city and the sanctuary.
And the sanctuary. So what was Daniel prophesying when he said the people of the prince? He was speaking of the people who worship the Prince of Darkness. Who tore Jerusalem down? You got it. The Romans. What is their religion of choice? Paganism. Who is their god? Pan, Satan, Zeus. So this is a spiritual battle. So it tells us in Daniel that the people of the prince shall destroy our homeland. What prince? The prince of darkness. So these people have a program that's given to them by what we call today alien forces, satanic forces. That's their agenda, to wipe out God's people. See? What else you have there?
This is St. John chapter 14, verse 30.
Go ahead.
Hereafter, I will not talk much with you.
Then Christ says, hereafter, I will not talk with you, knowing that his time would soon come. Read.
For the prince of this world.
For the prince of this world.
Cometh.
Cometh.
And have nothing in me.
And have nothing in me. Why am I bringing this out? Because it's deeper than just thinking that Satan is some fictitious spirit that randomly pick on people. No, Satan, the fallen one, Lucifer, Satan, is a meticulous general over an army with a plan and an agenda to destroy God's people. And he has a people that's operating for him. You understand? So the elected officials and those that are set up are only carrying out the program that's coming from the dark forces. Okay? You got Revelations? You have something else here? You get Ephesians 6?
Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12.
Read.
For we wrestle not against flesh and blood.
So it's deeper than just flesh and blood here. Read.
But against principalities.
Principalities.
Against powers.
Against powers.
Against the rulers of the darkness.
Against the rulers of the darkness.
Of this world.
Of this world.
Against spiritual wickedness in high places.
Spiritual wickedness in high places. It's talking about political positions that are given to those that are operating with this world under the guidelines of Satan. So when you look at the political positions, when you look at the Masonic positions, they're all controlled by Jabulon, which is Satan, or Yah, which is Satan. You understand? Now, let's go there. Revelations 12. More proof showing you that this was prophesied not only in the Old Testament. It was also prophesied in the book of Revelations. Even when Christ says, listen, when you shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies flee into the wilderness, flee into the mountains. It was speaking of how Satan and his people would impose their will on God's people, on the children of Israel, the people of the Bible, and look to utterly eradicate them. Read Revelations 12.
Revelations chapter 12, verse 1.
Read the 12th verse.
Verse 12. Therefore rejoice ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time.
So ever since Christ was crucified, the time that Satan would have start ticking down. You understand? That was the beginning of Satan's clock ticking down against him. That's why it says, woe unto the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea. Because he's going to come down on the people that's living in this earth knowing he have a short time. Now think about that. That means he would use anything in the earth to fulfill his will to get back into the heavens, even if it means destroying everyone in it. See? Read.
13. And when the dragon saw that he was cast unto the earth,
when he seen that he had no more access to the heavenly throne,
he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man child.
He persecuted the woman that brought forth the man child. The woman is Israel. So when it says he persecuted the woman that brought forth the man child, he persecuted the people who brought forth Christ, who had the power to ban Satan from the heavenly realm. So now, since he can't get Christ, he can't fight against Christ, his only pretext now is to what? To war against Christ's people. 70 AD. Read.
14. And to the woman were given two great wings of an eagle.
That means she flew. She fleed. How do we know that woman is the 12 tribes of Israel? Read up the first verse real quick.
Verse 1. And there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet.
Go ahead.
And upon her head a crown of 12 stars.
See, that 12 stars represents what? The 12 tribes of Israel. Go ahead. Read back where you were.
14. And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle.
So the Most High gave some direction to those that took heed to his prophecy. See, those that took heed to the prophecy didn't get destroyed in Masada in 70 AD. They went into Africa. They followed what Christ said. Read.
That she might fly into the wilderness.
Where it's prepared what?
that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place, where she is nourished for a time and times and a half time from the face of the serpent.
So the Most High gave us Africa as a nourishment against the face of the serpent people. See that? Africa was a refuge from our homeland. It wasn't the motherland. It was an alternative. See that? From the face of the serpent. Who was the serpent people? The Khazars. That was the religion of the Jewish people before they converted into Judaism. They were called the serpent people in Khazaria. If you don't believe me, type in serpent people Khazaria. If you're on your computers here. That's who they were. Khazar or Caesar. Khazar come from the word Caesar or Tsar. Like the Roman Tsars. They're the same people too. The German Tsars. They're all the same. The Queen of England. She's from the German Tsar bloodline. She's from the bloodline of Caesars. So is the Bushes. Who's controlling the United States. See? They lie. They assume other positions. Why? Because there's no rules in Satan's game. He can lie, steal, kill, and cheat. He say, listen, I don't got to tell the people who I am. They're the serpent people. They're the Romans. They're the Gentiles who have taken our homeland. Read.
15. And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman.
That water after the flood, that water which is a flood after the woman, was all the philosophies and lies and plans against the same people that ran out of where? Out of Israel and escaped. So since they couldn't kill us all at once in 70 AD because we took heed of Christ's prophecies, they began to come up with forms of philosophy and religion and a new form of education that would take us out. Since they couldn't take us out physically at first. So every place they go on their so-called missionaries is to bring this water, this flood of lies through philosophy or religion. And usually it encompasses paganism, idolatry, immorality, homosexuality, all the things with these, you know, IDs on the end is what they've placed on our people. Okay. Read.
That he might cause her to be carried away of the flood.
Of the flood. That's the lies they brought with their Roman imperialistic thinking. Read.
And the earth helped the woman.
When it says the earth helped the woman, how did the earth help the woman? We're going to show you. Read.
And the earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood which the dragon cast out of his mouth.
Because later on, because the Bible said you in Daniel that knowledge shall increase. We receive books that was hid by the Roman canon. And these books were found in the Qumran caves. Books like Enoch that came from the earth that was held in earthen pots by the Essenes. This information totally destroyed the lies and philosophies of the Jesuit church. It totally brings the full understanding of the scripture to the forefront. And it tear down all the lies that we were taught in our Christian churches. So that's what it means the earth helped the woman. The Most High put a spirit on the Essenes to hide certain records, like the book of Jasher, like the book of Enoch. Okay, even the 70 scriptures that was hid under Edras, that information was hid. So that we understand what happens after death. Read.
17. And the dragon was wroth with the woman.
Now the dragon, which is Satan, who's the father, the old serpent, the devil, who's the father of the serpent people. Read.
And went to make war with the remnant of her seed.
They went to make war with the remnant of her seed. Those who have escaped. You people in America, you people that are suffering on EPTs, you are the remnant of the seed. You are the children. You are the children of those who escaped the deluge in 70 AD. They didn't forget you. See? So he went to make war with the remnant. That means a small group that escaped. That seed that escaped what they did to us in 70 AD. See? So the elite powers with the ancient wisdom know exactly who you are. And while they teach you in your systems, in your schools, it doesn't matter, everyone is the same. But yet, they separate themselves due to bloodline. And I even hear, like I read some material, and I hear some of the Jewish people say that we must preserve our Jewish culture. We must have a place for Israel. But they don't say that for no other people. But yet they teach us that bloodline doesn't matter. See? Finish reading.
And went to make war with the remnant of her seed.
They went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which what?
Which keep the commandments.
Which keep the commandments, and that's why they teach you in your churches not to follow them. Read.
Which keep the commandments of the Most High.
And what?
And have the testimony of Yeshaya the Christ.
And have testimony of Christ. So they're looking to actually aim this war against that remnant that came from those that escaped. That would one day find out that we're the children of Israel and keep the commandments and follow Christ. So they're setting up the apparatus all at once to eventually destroy them. That's where the aim is. That's where it's being aimed towards, brothers and sisters. Those that keep the commandments of the Most High and what?
And have the testimony of Yeshaya.
And have the testimony of the Yeshaya. Now, who's destroying us? The serpent people are destroying us. Who are they? Romans. Regardless of what they call themselves today, they're Romans. Who are they? Serpent people. Let's get Revelations 2 and 9 and Revelations 3 and 9 real quick. And then I'm going to make a statement, open questions for 10 minutes, and wish you all Godspeed.
Revelations 2 and 9. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich.
The Most High says he know our poverty. He know our tribulation. What people is he speaking of? Those that are under Christ. The Israelites, the Jews that were under Christ. He know that we're impoverished. So this can't be speaking of the bankers and those that control the world. And then he know what?
And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews.
And he know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews.
And are not.
And are not. They're Romans. They're the serpent people that have an agenda to destroy the elect. But are who?
But are the synagogue of Satan.
Who worship in synagogues? They are the synagogue of Satan. The chief house of Satan. That means Satan's agenda comes through them. Who are the them? Those that say they are Jews and are not. That means Satan's agenda would chiefly come through these people. They'll teach nationalistic teachings and preservation for themselves while planning the demise for the rest of us. Read on. No, there's one more thing in there. In 2 and 9.
Verse 10.
It
says,
here's the key point.
Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer.
We are not to fear anything that they may do to us.
Behold. The devil shall cast some of you into prison.
Fusion centers. See that? The industrial prison complex. Who's behind it? Those that say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. Who's in the prisons? To show you what the plan of the prison complex, what it was about when they first constructed it. It wasn't about just locking up criminals. Who are they locking up? Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison. Right there in the Bible, with a little history, in the Bible, we covered fusion centers, FEMA, Homeland Security. We covered borders. We covered riots. We covered everything that's in the news, but yet no one is telling you it's Bible prophecy aimed towards a people. So the question might be, well, what do we do? First thing we do. as a people is come back to the Most High God. Follow His law, statutes, and commandments. That's number one. Number two, link up with people in like mind. Stop trying to force what you know on other people. You cannot cast your pearls before swine, lest they rend you under feet. You're telling people what's going on who really could care less, and they're going to look to destroy you. Mosiah said, "Blessed." Christ says, "Blessed are your eyes that you see and your ears that you hear." He gave you the information for you so that you can do something, so that you can link it back to the Father. Not to try to convince someone who's adamantly fighting against you. Another thing, physical planning, because faith without works is dead. You cannot say you down with the Most High and have some understanding of the Most High and not have plans according to His will with Scripture. Yeah, faith kicks in. But you must have some type of contingency plans, knowing that they're looking to destroy you all at once, right now. So the contingency plan should be brothers and sisters of like mind coming together and having a plan for when there's no food and no water. And whatever plan you have it be amongst other believers. If something happens where someone have to flee from one place and go to another, and it got to be some plans to hold excesses of food so that if they do cut off EPTs and cut off whatever, you have food rations for a time. And you have to have contingency plans, fuel, water, and ultimately contingency plans to move from one place to the next if need be. You understand? Because the powers of this world, they're not going to slow up their program. They come in full throttle with this program. I mean, it's to the point where I'm looking at this. It's almost an event per week now. Usually, it used to be every 6 months or back then, every couple of years, you would see something and you don't hear from it for a while. But now, it's an event almost a week now, per week. Another thing happened in so-called LAX. And I'm looking right at it. I'm saying, okay, another false flag. What is this? Okay, now they're going to arm TSA. Common sense will tell you that. Obviously, there was no fund. I mean, the funding they had for the TSA is running out. People are saying the TSA is useless because they are. Well, we need an event there so that the funding can continue. And now we can arm TSA. So now they're going to arm an armed unit that they're going to switch out soon with foreign troops. But they're getting you used to it by first acclimating within the TSA. But these people that's working at TSA, you're going to be moved soon. And the armed guards will be foreign troops. Okay? So that's what's going on. They're militarizing us all over the earth, against us all over the earth. They're setting up their garrisons just like 70 AD. And we must take heed to the Most High's prophecies. Okay? And this is not about trying to convince someone what the Most High is saying either. And guess what? Christ only said that once. He didn't have to drop that again. You that have an ear, hear. Okay? Christ didn't have to keep dropping it over and over again. So I wanted to put that out there to show you that we're entering a serious phase of the final siege. Shalom.